So let me see, in the earlier class, you had said that reported two problems with a complete Keynesian model. One was regarding the price expectations part, and the other was regarding the shifts in the aggregate supply curve. So today I'll start with these two, and if possible, I'll go to monetarism. Otherwise, we'll discuss that later. Now, before coming to the price expectations, let me first start off with the issue of money wages in the complete Keynesian model. Otherwise, if I just jump to the price expectations part, it will be a bit difficult to, it may be a bit difficult for you to understand why we are discussing this issue. See, in the classical model, the contracts were set in terms of money wage. Okay, so when you come to the labor market, workers goes to the labor market. They bargain with the producers, and they set a money wage. This money wage is perfectly flexible. Okay. Now the advantage in the classical model is that the workers also know, workers have perfect information, so they know what is the price level. So if they set W and they know what price is, then that means they are basically bargaining in terms of real wage. Is this clear, everyone?
Yes.
Okay. Just to give an example, suppose price is 2. That means if you want a real wage of 5, let us say, what should you bargain for in money wage? You should bargain for a money wage of 10. In that case, you get your target real wage of 5, right? If you know that the price is 1 rupee, price is 1, then instead of bargaining for a money wage of 10, you are going to bargain for a money wage of 5. In that case, your real wage will be 5. So if you have perfect information about prices, although you bargain for money wage, you're actually settling the real wage. In the classical model, the labor market had another characteristic. The money wage was perfectly flexible. So that means if you have unemployment, then the money wage is going to go down so that demand goes up and the unemployment will be eliminated. Similarly, if you have excess demand for labor, money wages will simply rise and again the excess demand for labor is going to be eliminated. In the Keynesian case, however, you have this rigidity is not, this flexibility in the money wage is absent. Okay. So Keynes argues that the source of wage rigidity is the fact that they are basically trying to maintain a relative wage structure. Okay. You have formal contracts, you don't have informal contracts, etc. So in the Keynesian model, I hope you understood why the sources of rigidity. I'm not discussing that unless you want me to. So in the Keynesian model, we had a fixed money wages. So prices are allowed to vary, but you have fixed money wages. Now, what do we mean by fixed money wages? it doesn't mean that money wages will not change. What it basically means is that there's a certain limit. There's a floor below which money wage will not fall. Okay, so money wage can rise. Workers will accept an increase in money wage, but there is a limit below which they will not accept a further decline in money wages. Okay, so for instance, just to give an example, suppose this is the minimum money wage. Okay, so if this is the demand and supply, wages will rise to over here. That is not a problem. But suppose the supply curve increases. Okay. Again, this is the equilibrium wage, and the workers will accept a decrease in money wages. So this will go on until this point, right? If there's a further decrease in money wages, then this is the equilibrium money wage. Workers will say, no, we will not accept any further decrease in money. Okay. So if you look at it carefully, when does this problem arise? The problem will arise if you have a situation like this. This is the equilibrium money wage, and this is the minimum money wage. Okay, if this condition is satisfied, then the issue of downward rigidity arises. But if you have a situation like this, this is W min, you have supply curves like this, so that WE is greater than W min. So at this point, wages are flexible. Okay, is this part clear?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So this is the structure. So when is money wage, rigid money wage important? When you have a situation like this. Okay. In other words, the intersection occurs below the minimum money wage. Okay. So this is the minimum money wage, and this is where you have the equilibrium. Okay, so over here, this is the minimum money wage. We have excess supply. Normally, we would expect workers will want to reduce the money wage. They are prepared to accept a wage cut and come to here. But Keynes says, no, at this point, we are not going to accept the wage cut. Okay, so suppose you have an increase, a shift in the money demand, in the labor demand function over here. Okay, so labor demand is shifting. The ND curve is shifting from D1, D2, D3. Why is it shifting? Remember, the demand function for labor is price into marginal product of labor. Okay, so if you have flexible prices increases, then this is P1 into MP, this is P2 into MP, this is P3 into MP. So the money demand function, so the labor demand function is going to shift upwards. Now, what is the effect of this shift? The effect of this shift is that you're going to, the unemployment level is going to decrease. Initially, this is the unemployment level from this point to this point. if prices increases, demand will go up and unemployment is going to come down to this. If prices rise to P3, unemployment will fall even further to P3, to this level. Right? However, there is no change in the money wage. It is always W bar. Okay? So that means, if you think about it, do we require the supply function in order to find out what is the amount of labor which will be employed? So in this diagram, this second diagram, how do we determine how many workers will be employed? Normally we look at the intersection of the demand and supply curve, but here do we look at this intersection? We don't. Yeah, go on. Someone unmuted. Okay. So what is happening is we are simply looking at the intersection of the demand function and this minimum wage line. The supply function does not come into the picture at all. Is that clear?
Yes.
Again, look at this carefully. This is the minimum wage. The demand function is changing. Right? So without looking at the supply function, we can find out what is the how many workers will be employed. Yeah. So we don't need the supply function over here. So that is why over here we only require the demand function. We do not the demand for labor. We don't need the supply of labor. This is the minimum wage line, the line that I've drawn below. So I simply have to look at the intersection of the demand function with this minimum wage line. So when price is changing, if price increases, the value of marginal product of labor curve, price into MP, is going to shift outwards. So the intersection occurs, the intersection points is to the right of the earlier intersection point. The wage rate remains same, only the amount of labor that is employed increases. So for different price levels, for P0, this is the VMP curve, we are employing N0. When price is P1, how many workers are we employing? N1. For P2, we are employing N2, right? So what we have is, we have over here three prices, and corresponding to them from panel 1, this is figure A, we can find out the amount of workers employed. Now, given the production function in panel B, N0 means we are going to produce Y0, Y1, and Y2. So this is from panel 2, N2 and Y2, right? So now what we can do is, we can link up prices and income. If prices is going up, output is also increasing. So we get a positively sloped curve. We are taking the Y from here and the price from these three prices to get the aggregate supply function. Is it clear, everyone?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Now, before moving to the point where you had a problem, note that this over here, how much, if the price is going up, what is the increase in employment, this amount? Okay. Now, let us come to the supply function. If we remove the wage rigidity problem and assume that wages are flexible, then we have to bring back the supply of labor function. Now, how many workers are employed? What is the wage rate? That depends upon two things: the demand for labor and the supply of labor. The intersection of these two curves will give me the wage and employment, right? Now, we know how the demand function for labor is determined. Keynes assumed that the supply function depends upon real wages. So, although we bargain for money wages, workers know that money wages is not important. More important is the real wages. And this is something which is very intuitive. This function should be a positive function. If real wage goes up, supply of labor also goes up. So that means you have a positively sloped supply function. Okay. Now, the point from where I started, the real wage. Okay. So if I want to deter, if I have to decide on how much labor to supply, I need to know what is the real wage. Now, there's no problem with W because I'm going to the labor market and I'm going to bargain for W. In the classical model, prices were known. So that means the real wage became automatic. Once I set W, the real wage is also automatically determined and workers know it. When we come to the Keynesian model, the first part is similar to the classical model. Workers go to the labor market and they bargain with the producers for money wages. But unlike the classical system, they do not know what the prices are. So they know what W is, they don't know what prices are. So how will they determine real wages? So now expectations become important. In the absence of perfect information about prices, workers form expectations of what the price level is going to be. So in the earlier slide, I had written NS is a function of WP, but because prices are unknown, Keynes makes this substitution. The supply function depends upon W by expected prices. Now the question is, how are expected prices determined? Okay. Do you have a problem with this part, this slide?
I don't have a problem, sir. Now I don't know about the rest.
Okay. So basically what is happening is, Keynes assumed that the expected price expectations are formed on the basis of the past price levels. Okay, it's a very simple backward-looking model. And as a result of this, because it is backward-looking, the current economic situation, what is happening now, is going to affect not P minus 1, P minus 2, P minus 3, it is going to affect P0. So what is happening now will not affect expectations. So that means expectation, there's a expectations, the relation between expectations and policy changes are removed. There's no link between policy change and expectations. A policy change will not affect or change expectations in the current period. Okay. Now let us see how the model changes. Suppose price increases from P0 to P1, right? What will happen to the value of marginal physical marginal product? This is instead of P0 into MP, it is now P1 into MP. So you can see that the supply demand function is going to shift out. Okay. In the earlier example, we did not have to consider the supply function. We simply looked at W0, that was constant. So whatever be the labor demand, supply was automatically forthcoming. But now, if you want more workers to come into the market, you have to offer a higher wage rate because the market is always cleared. The wage rate is always set at the intersection of the demand and supply functions. So if this is the demand function, this will be the wage rate. W0 is the wage rate. N0 is the number of workers. When the prices increases to P1, the marginal product shifts outwards, wage goes up, and number of workers employed also goes up to N1. And in this way, we have a link between P2, W2, and N2, right? So just working as before, we have P0, N0, and from panel B, N0 will give me Y0. So now I can link P0 and Y0 to get the supply function. So again, we are going to get a positively sloped supply function. Okay, is this part clear? The basic nature of the supply function will not change. How we derive the supply function, aggregate supply function of output, that will not change.
So basically, yeah. Here we consider the supply function that we were not considering in the downward wage rigidity case. Yeah. But here, since wage is flexible, we have to bring that into account.
Yeah.
Okay.
Okay. So if you look at the diagram, in both cases, we had a positively sloped supply function. I'm talking about panel C, the AS function. Then what is the difference? Now let us come to the difference. See, this is blue line is the minimum wage. I brought the two models together. The blue line is the minimum wage. Now let us suppose prices goes up. Okay. So P0 MP and this is P1 MP. The demand function shifts rightwards. If you have downward wage rigidity, what will be the increase in employment? See, the equilibrium will be given by the intersection of the brown line and the blue line. Ignore the green line. We are not looking into the supply function. So point T, and then we are going to look into the new intersection of the demand and the blue line. So employment goes up from E to EF. EF means fixed money wage, and EV is variable money wage. So what is the employment? It goes up to NF, right? But if you have downward wage rigidity, how is the equilibrium determined? It is determined by the intersection of the demand and supply curves. To repeat, in case of the downward rigid model, equilibrium is given by the intersection of the demand function with the blue line representing the minimum wage, right? But when we move to the variable wage model, equilibrium is given by the intersection of the demand and supply functions. So instead of the equilibrium shifting to EF, the equilibrium will now be EV, right? And it is very obvious that you are going to employ a lesser number of workers. So instead of a shift from N to NF, the shift will be only N to NV. Right?
So, but we are considering downward wage rigidity. So when the curve is shifting, like...
No, I have said, I've brought the two models together. In the sense, I'm looking at it in the same graph.
Okay.
I'm comparing the wage, downward wage rigidity with variable wages.
Okay.
So the blue line is for the downward rigid model. And the green line is for the flexible model. Okay.
Okay, sir. Got it.
And the brown line is for both the cases. Right? So that means this is the first... If I go, if I restate the problem, if I'm looking at the down fixed wage model, this is the intersection of the brown and the blue line. When prices changes, this is the intersection. Okay, so N and NF. If I'm considering the variable wage model, then I have to look at the brown line and the green line. So how much does, what is the employment now? Initially N, when prices changes, it goes up to NV. Okay. So blue is the fixed money wage and green is the variable money wage model. Okay. Now it's very obvious that NF is greater than NV, right? So this is what I've written. So what will be the corresponding output? Which output will be greater? Will the output be greater in this case or in this case?
Downward wage
rigidity. In the F case, it will be greater.
Output will be greater for the this case. Okay. So P0, this gives me N, and this gives me, let us say, Y0. Okay. If I'm going to the fixed wage case, and if I have a variable case, it's still P1. Right? So if I have NV is less than NF, YV will also be less than YF. Okay? So I'm starting from Y0. See, the price in both cases, the price is the same. Okay. So in case of the fixed model, this is my configuration. In case of the variable model, my configuration is this. This is how I'm going to draw the supply function. Okay, so P0, Y0, I've got this point. Price goes up to P1. What is output? Output is YF. Okay, so I get this point. Now I'm going to the variable wage. I again start from the same point, this point. Price goes up to P1, so the price is same. But will the output be same? How much will output increase? The output will not increase by YF, but by a lesser amount. So that means you're going to have an output level like this, right? So that means the aggregate supply function will now be steeper. Is this clear?
Yes, sir.
Okay, so it's simply you have to look at price, you have to find out what is the corresponding employment and what is the corresponding Y. Okay, you basically have to, how are we constructing the aggregate supply? Like this. This is the first part, this is the second part, and in order to construct the aggregate supply, we link these two. Okay. So we okay, so we can see that in case of the, if we extend the Keynesian model, the standard Keynesian model, we relax the assumption of downward wage rigidity, then the aggregate supply schedule is still upward sloping. Right. But the only difference is that the supply function is going to be steeper. That is the only change. What I've written over here. The supply function is going to be steeper than the rigid wage case. So the supply function will be like this. This is the variable case and this is the fixed or rigid case. Okay. This is the only difference. The slope. Apart from that, there's no difference. So basically, this implies that if you are looking at policy changes, it's going to be qualitatively same. If the aggregate demand shifts outwards, if there's any change in the fiscal or monetary policy, as a result of which the demand curve shifts from here to here, and you have an upward sloping supply function, you're going to get the increase in demand is going to lead to higher level of prices and also higher output levels. Okay, so price and output both are going to go up. This result is same in both the models, whether it is variable or whether it is wages are rigid. The only difference is how much will price change, how much will output increase. That is the only difference between the two models. Again, if you think about it, just forget about macro. Just think of it in terms of micro. So I've drawn two demand functions. Now I'm going to draw two supply functions. Okay. So look at it. We start from here, and these are the equilibrium. So this is the flexible money wage, and this is the aggregate supply for rigid money wage. This is AD1, this is AD2. This is Y, this is price. So you start from E1, and these are the two due equilibrium. This is for the flexible case, this is for the rigid case. Okay. So in both cases, you can see that prices will go up and output will go up in both cases. But the only difference is how much does price rise? Well, this is not very important. What is more important is how much does output increase? Because after all, this is our target. This is the objective of government intervention, of monetary and fiscal policy. Right? We want to increase output. So as a result of an expansionary monetary policy or an expansionary fiscal policy, the demand curve will shift. How effective it is depends on what happens in the labor market. So can you tell me that when is an expansionary policy more effective? If you have rigid money wages or flexible money wages?
Rigid case, sir.
Rigid case, sir.
In the rigid case. So that is all. Okay, so then we are looking at the qualitative difference. Output increases by less. Now the other point, how much does price goes up? Okay, if you look at it, if you compare the differences, output increases more in the rigid wage model. What about prices?
So it's the same.
Is it? What is the initial price?
So the initial one.
This is the initial price.
Then the flexible case, it increases more.
Yeah.
In case of prices.
This is? Right? So keep in mind in this fact. So in a rigid wage model, you can write this in another way. In a rigid model, wage model, output increases more, but price increases less. And in a flexi wage model, the output increase is less, but the price increase is more. Okay? It's just a different way of saying the same thing. Okay? Any problems with this?
No, sir.
So this is what I've written, that if the money wages is fixed, the increase in output will be less, price level will rise more. And the reason is simply the difference in slope of the aggregate supply curve, right? Okay. So again, this is what I have shown over here. The increase in output and price in the two models. Okay. Please give me one sec. I'll switch on the light and come back. See, if you think about it, why is the difference? So in these two slides, I'm trying to explain why we have the difference. Okay. See, in case of the money wage model, remember that the labor supply is not a problem. We have excess supply of labor. Okay. This is similar to the simple Keynesian model, what happens in the commodity market. See, normally, if demand increases, what would you expect to happen to prices in the market?
So they will increase.
Prices should go up. But if you have, if you remember in the simple Keynesian model, we had excess capacity. Okay, factories were running idle. There were unemployed workers. So if demand increases, will prices go up? You're simply going to use the excess capacity. You're simply going to supply more at the same prices. And this is what is happening now in the labor market. In the simple Keynesian model, we had a structure mechanism in the commodity market. Now this is what is happening in the labor market. Because we have excess supply of labor, we have a pool of surplus labor who are sitting idle. Any increase in demand will not lead to an increase in wages. Right.
So could
However,
you keep the last point, like demand increases, we still use the existing supply of labor.
over here.
Yes, sir.
Money wage is fixed at W equal to zero. Prices shift. Employment rises. It moves from here to here. You mean this line?
No, sir, I was asking what you said just like before,
Okay.
like money wages, like we use the existing supply of labor
Yeah, see
even.
what happens is that at any point of time, you have 50, 60, you have a pool of people who are just sitting idle, who want work but are not getting the work. Okay.
Yes,
So
sir.
in this situation, instead of, see, normally what happens is all of you are working. So if I want you to work more, how can I induce you to work more? By increasing your wages, right? But if I have a group of unemployed workers, then I can tell you that, look, you go on working as you have done before. I need more output. Prices have gone up. I want to supply a larger volume of output. And in order to produce this extra output, I will simply hire these unemployed workers. You don't have to put in extra effort. There are some people who are sitting idle, they want to work. I will employ them. And they will be willing to work at the same wage rate. Right?
Yes, sir. Understood, sir.
Okay. But when we are moving to the flexible wage rate, do we have these unemployed people? All of you are working, right? Because remember that when wages are flexible, the labor market is always at the intersection of the demand and supply functions. All people who are willing to work at the going wage rate will get employment. Clear? That is the market mechanism. What we mean by equilibrium. You have read this in micro percent. So now, as a producer, I find that prices have gone up, commodity prices have gone up. So this induces me, this encourages me to supply, to take advantage of this and produce, increase my production level. Right? For this, I require more workers. Now, in the previous case, I had unemployed workers whom I could hire. But now everyone who wants to work is working. So how do I get you to work more?
By paying them extra.
Yeah. So I pay you extra. But when I'm paying you extra, see, I want to hire 100 people, let us say, at a wage rate of 5. But now these 100 people says that, okay, we are willing to work, but we will not work at 5 rupees. You have to pay everyone 10 rupees. And everyone means not only these new workers, but also the existing workers. Because otherwise, you are going to go on strike. So in that case, this will dampen my willingness to hire 100 workers.
Yes,
I'm
sir.
willing. So what I'm going to do is, okay, I'll pay you 10 rupees, but in that case, I won't hire 100. 80 people will come, should come to me. Or not even that, I won't accept, I won't pay you 10, 10 rupees, I'll pay you 8 rupees. In that case, only 80 people are willing to work. Right? So now what happens is, because wages, in the second model, in the flexible model, I can increase the number of workers only by hiring more, by offering them a higher wage rate. That dampens my incentive to increase employment. Okay. So in the first model, prices goes up. There's a positive effect. I want to hire more workers. Here, this effect is also there. Prices goes up, I want to hire more workers. But there's also a negative side coming into play. Wages will go up. This dampens my incentive to hire 100 workers. So I do end up by hiring more workers, but it is less than in the previous case.
Sir, could you show the previous slide once? Thank you, sir.
Okay. So if you look at this, as output increases, this is the relation. Just as output will increase because labor is going up. So if labor increases, MPN will fall. It basically means you have a downward sloping marginal product curve. Okay. So if you have a downward sloping marginal cost curve, see, as the what happens is, if you want to hire, if you want to increase output, the marginal cost is given by W by MPN. I had shown this result in the first set. So this is the result you should be able to derive. Okay. Now what happens is W is constant, so only MPN is falling. And as a result, marginal cost is going up. When you have flexible money wages, MPN is falling. This is leading to an increase in marginal cost. At the same time, W is also going up, which leads to a further increase in marginal cost. So this productivity effect is there in both the models. But the increase in money wage leading to an increase in marginal cost, that is there only in the flexible case. This component is there. The change in W is there only in this model. So cost of production rises in both cases, but here you have an increase in the numerator, a decrease in denominator, so the cost of production will rise more. Is it clear? See, in this model, money is fixed, you have MPN, right? So as you hire more workers, MPN will fall. If the denominator falls, what happens to marginal cost? It is going to go up. See, cost of production rises. So if I ask you to supply me, see, now I'm a consumer. If I go and ask the producer that, look, you please increase your supply. He will say that, okay, if I want to increase your supply, I will increase your supply. But look, price marginal cost has gone up. If I increase supply, the marginal cost of producing will go up. So if you want me to supply more, you will have to offer me a higher commodity price. In this case, marginal cost is variable. So now I have two effects. W increases, marginal cost goes up, MPN falls, marginal cost goes up. So what is the effect? The increase in marginal cost is more than in this case. Do you understand what I've said? That is why if the marginal cost increases more, you'll obviously ask for a higher price. See, suppose I ask you to increase production, right? Your marginal cost increases by, suppose your current price is 5 rupees. Okay. So if I ask you to increase production, your marginal cost will go up by 1 rupee. How much price will you want? Suppose your profit is zero. Forget about profits. What is the minimum price that you will want? Yeah, did you understand the question?
Sir, could you repeat once?
Yeah, suppose the current price is 5 rupees. Okay. So I ask you that, okay, you are the producer, please supply an extra unit. And your marginal cost increases by 1 rupee. Okay. Now, let us assume for simplicity that you're not interested in profits. Okay. So, what is the price that you will now want?
Six rupees.
It will be six.
6 rupees, yes.
Suppose marginal cost increases not by 1 but by 2 units. What is the price that you will want?
7.
So in both cases you are increasing output by 1 unit, right? In this case you want an additional price of 1 rupee. Here the additional price is 2 rupees. So what, how will it translate in terms of wages? In terms of prices. So this is one. In one case, you are just wanting an increase in 1. This is the rigid wage case. In the flexible case, you want prices to go up by 2. So what will be the supply curve? Which one will be steeper? This one or this one? Logical. It's just intuition. So by construction itself, the supply function in case of the flexible money wage will be
steeper.
Steeper. Okay. I think this is also where you had some problem. Shifts in the aggregate supply curve. Right? Okay. I'll give you just 1 or 2 minutes so that you can digest what I have said. See, I mean, when you're trying to construct, don't try to think ahead. Take it step by step, okay? And try to think of it logically. Economics is not something which is illogical. Common sense can help you to go a lot. You can solve most of what is being taught at this level using simply common sense. All my partners. Okay, now coming to the aggregate supply curve. Was someone saying anything?
No, sir. I just clicked on the mic button instead.
Okay. So what in the simple Keynesian model, this was the aggregate supply. Sorry, I've drawn the... So it was only the position of the aggregate demand curve which was determining the output level. Supply did not come into the picture. But if the supply function becomes positively sloped, then prices and output will be jointly determined by the aggregate demand and aggregate supply functions. So therefore, if there's any change or shift in the aggregate supply function, that is going to play a major role in the model. Okay, that is why we are looking at the aggregate supply function. Now, why did it become important? Okay. Now, you know that the Keynesians had mainly focused on the demand side. They were looking at, they were trying to explain, I mean, if you look at Lord Keynes typically, his general theory of, for instance, in his book, he tried to explain what was happening in the world economy or in the economy of US and UK using shifts in the demand function, in the aggregate demand curve. If you extend it slightly and introduce a positively sloped supply function, then, which makes the model more realistic, this is an extension of the pure Keynesian model. Again, you can simply look at the demand side, what is happening to the demand side. So you have the government intervention, which changes, increases the level of demand. And as the aggregate demand curve shifts rightwards and upwards, what is going to happen? What is happening over here as we are moving along these three equilibrium points?
They're both price and output.
Both price and output is going up. Okay. Now, in the 1970s, what happened was prices had gone up in the US. Now, if I want to look, if I'm using this model, what should have happened to output?
What was this? Straight line.
No, just look at this diagram. Prices are going up. What will happen to output?
It must increase.
Output must also go up like this. You're moving up like this. The equilibrium points are like this, these. But what we observed was that output did not really increase. It was more or less, it in fact decreased, or it was more or less constant. Okay.
Sir, that's what I was saying. So in US at that time, maybe the curve would have been a straight line.
No. You mean that this is the, you have the traditional P pure Keynesian case, horizontal supply curve. No, vertical. You mean, sorry, vertical, vertical. That is an extreme case? No. That is what we call the classical case, right?
Yes, sir.
Now, the problem over here, what we saw in the US economy, that cannot be explained by shifts in the aggregate demand curve. That's very clear. If you're thinking about shifts in demand curve, either if you have upward shifts, increase in demand, both price and output is going to go up. If you have decreases in demand, both price and output is going to fall. What you're seeing is something completely different. You can't explain this in terms of demand side economics. So the Keynesians realize that they have to modify the theory still further. Instead of assuming a horizontal supply curve, they had moved to a positively sloped supply curve. Now they must incorporate the fact that this supply curve can also shift. Look at this. The supply function is shifting. What is happening? Prices are going up. And simultaneously, what is happening? Output is falling. Exactly what had happened in the US economy. Prices are rising, output minus, so output is falling. Okay, so in this part, you can see that as prices are rising, in fact, over here also, the increase in output is declining. Here it is negative. So the experience of the US economy in the 70s cannot be explained in terms of the conventional Keynesian model, shifts in the demand curve. We have to go for supply side economics to some extent. Okay. Now, what are the factors that shift the aggregate supply curve? See, the points on the aggregate supply curve, what do we mean by aggregate supply? You have read micro, right? What is the supply definition of the supply function?
So basically, gives us different levels of output that firms are willing to supply for a given price level.
Yeah. So it's nice that you're reading my slide, but
yes.
Yeah, but I mean, is it different from the what MD taught? Am I using a different definition of aggregate supply? I mean, the only definition is MD talked about supply of a firm of a market. I'm talking about the economy. I'm more inclusive. She's talking about 1, 50, 20. I'm talking about billions. Numbers sanctify. Okay. So, what are the factors that shift the aggregate supply curve? Again, this is, you basically require micro. See, the output level, see, at any point of time, suppose you have a price P, and if you have perfect competition, what is the profit maximizing condition? Price equal to MC. Remember? I think this is not MD, this is SM. Am I right?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Okay, so MD, SM, they have already taught you macro before I started the course. So the output level that maximizes profit is given by the condition price equal to MC. Okay. Now, let us look into this marginal cost. Again, this is what I discussed in the earlier slide. Marginal cost is increase in cost due to production of extra unit. So I produce more, how much will my cost go up? Now, the production function is given by Q as a function of labor. Capital is held constant. So if I want to increase output, then I have to use more labor. So the marginal cost function, MC, can be said to be equal to W into MPN. Right? This is, it should be obvious to you. What is MC? MC is DC by DQ. Okay. Now, if you have only one unit, only one variable factor, labor. Okay, output has gone up. How do you increase output? By increasing labor supply. So what is the increased cost? Simply W into DL. And I can write this as right. Okay. Now, as I increase employment, marginal product is going to fall. Okay. So that means I'm increasing N. I'm going down the marginal product curve. Now, what is happening? N1 and N2. Okay. I want to employ, my labor demand has gone up. So if I want to hire more workers, I'll have to give them more wages. Okay. And this is going to increase my marginal cost. Okay. Now, if you have a an leftward, so upward shifted aggregate supply, what does it mean? Your output is the same. Now you want a higher price. Why do you want the higher price? Because as you have seen over here, marginal cost is going to go up. If you want to increase production, your marginal cost is going to go up. And therefore, in order to maintain the condition price equal to MC, you have to increase, you require a higher price. It's as simple as that. So this is one way of saying firms will produce the same output only for a higher price level. If your marginal cost goes up, the firms will produce the same Y only if they are paid a higher prices. We can also say this in another way, that if the price remains same and marginal cost goes up, then they are going to reduce output. Okay. So one is, I'm looking like this, I'm keeping Y constant and looking at price. Here I'm keeping price constant and looking at Y. Now, suppose the marginal cost shifts upward. Okay, that means the output is the same. The marginal, for the same level of output, your marginal cost has gone up. Okay. So, if you have a constant price level, how can you ensure that price equal to marginal cost? So you at this point, there has been certain changes in the economy as a result of which the marginal cost function has shifted to MC2. So for Y1, your output is Y1 output, your marginal cost has gone up. So now what is the relation between price and marginal cost? Marginal cost is greater than price, right? How can you bring marginal cost back to price? you have to reduce your output level so that you move down the marginal cost function like this. You come back, and at this point, price is equal to marginal cost. Okay, is this part clear? This is simply microeconomics. Instead of writing S, I've just written AS. That is all. So is it clear, everyone? Or do you want me to repeat any point? Kilaj, acho tumra naki?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir, it's clear, sir.
Okay. Now, why will the marginal cost shift upwards? One is cost push factors. See, I had talked about expected prices. See, what can happen is the workers may believe that prices are going to go up in the future. They have seen that there has been inflation in the past, so they revise their expected price upwards. Okay, in that case, what happens is, if the expected price goes up, remember supply is a function of W by P. So again, I'm not explaining this, but again, if you realize, if you think about it intuitively, if expected price goes up, then the supply function of labor will shift leftwards. Okay, so as a result of this, you have higher wage rate. Demand, the number of workers falls, prices goes up. Okay, so you have a typical situation of what was happening in the US economy. Prices are rising, but output is falling. Apart from labor, we also use other variable inputs. Prices of raw materials, particularly imported oil, which is a major input. This can really push up domestic prices. And although it occurs with a lag, it can lead to a change in price expectations. So actually, this is what had happened in the US economy in terms of the oil shocks, not the wage part, but in terms of oil shocks. In 73, as I mentioned several times, there was a fourfold increase in the oil price due to the OPEC cartel. Then, this is roughly 73. Then again in 79-80, when the Iran revolution occurred, there was again a huge jump. So there was a jump over here, another jump over here. See, normally, I mean, in a perfectly functioning market economy, you should have a shift to cheaper substitutes. To some extent, this is what happened. People tried to shift to coal, natural gas, etc., away from oil. But still, even if you're demanding more of coal, more of natural gas, their prices also is going to go up. So what happened was the energy prices, initially of oil, then of coal, natural gas, etc., increased. And as a result of this, the workers revised their price expectations and the supply curve, the supply of labor started shifting upwards. And from here, you can see, it's easy to see over here that the prices are going to go up, but instead of output rising, output is going to fall. Okay, so this is what happened throughout the 80s. So this is, I'm looking at what happened in the US economy, but this is basically the mechanism. Okay, so is it enough, or I mean, did you have any problem with these parts? No, this is only that thing. So the Keynes, complete Keynesian model. Do you have any doubts in any other area? Will I go through the slides again? I mean, just show you the slides.
So for me, it's fine. Like, you can ask us.
Okay, so Complete Kenshin, all of you are wizards in Complete Kenshins?
Sir, not wizards, but so far it's fine.
Yes, sir, not wizards.
You're muggles?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So now we have two options. I can give you a 10-15 minutes break, and then I can come back and cover the monetarist counter-revolution. Not the entire part, but at least there were three questions which were raised, two by you and one by Pikachu. So I can discuss that, or we can keep the classical the model for the next day. But MD has asked me to cover. No, actually, you don't have econometrics, do you?
No, sir.
You
no,
have
sir.
Statistics.
Not yet.
Okay. Oh, it's not for you then. So what do you want? You can put up your hand. Will I come back and cover this monetarist counter-revolution after a break? Or will I postpone it to Wednesday, next Wednesday?
So can you do it next Wednesday?
Yeah, so then I think like we can like at least
okay,
I
in that
can
case
come
you
up with more questions. Yes, sir.
Okay, so yeah. You can practice your spells and...
Exactly, sir.
Yes, sir.
Okay. But then we'll start with a tri-visit competition. Well, not tri-visit, it will have to be multi-visit. Okay?
Yes.
So, okay, so Ronak, I'm sorry, you'll have to...
Sir, he's not in the meet. He texted me, he's having problems with his phone.
Okay. Okay, so tell him that you will have to keep his curiosity unsatisfied till next Wednesday.